about today's worship service with 10,000 reasons, or bless the Lord. So I invite everyone to stand as you're able. As we come together, make a joyful noise.
Oh,
seated, everyone.
Welcome. It is so good to be with you in worship this morning. This is a Sunday when, at our later service, we'll be welcoming some new members, and at both services, we honor our high school seniors. And I see a couple of you in our gathering this morning, a few of you, and at the end we'll invite you forward to be blessed and to receive some touchable, tangible blessings of a beautiful needlepoint piece as well as a quilt. We want to welcome all of our guests. If you are visiting with us, please fill out a visitor card and just put it in the offering plate when it comes through so that Pastor Patty and I can reach out to you and welcome you. And also, this is a service that is very flowing and spirit-led, so you won't see as many things that you have to say back or things printed out, but you are invited in times of prayer to offer prayer silently or aloud later on in our service. And for now, though, I'll open us with prayer, and then we'll have a moment of quiet as well as a chance to gather. Let us pray. Holy God, God with us, God for us, thank you for being the God who journeys with us through all of our lives, and thank you for being the God who brings us together this day. We know, Lord, that you are the God who is the true healer in all of the ways, and we lift before you now those places in our hearts and in our relationships that are in need of your healing. And we ask that you were to forgive the places in our lives where we have caused damage to others, and that you would open us to the good news of your unconditional love. We pause now. God, thank you for being the healer who has come to heal all of this world, to make life right for all. May we trust in the promise that in Christ Jesus, you have forgiven all of our sin, and you lead us to be vessels of that healing power. Amen. And now I invite you also to greet one another. We are reconciled with God, and we also greet one another with welcome and with peace. So I invite you to turn to those around you. You can stand up, it makes it easier. And to share a sign of peace with each other. Gospel story.
The gospel this morning comes to us from Matthew chapters 9, verses 9 through 13 and 20 to 22. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at the dinner table in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. for I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners. Then suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she said to herself, if I only touch his cloak, I will be made well. Jesus turned, and seeing her, he said, take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well. And instantly the woman was made well. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Children are heading off to children's church. Bye. Thank you, Klaus. So when I read the gospel lesson for today that Klaus just read for you, I could picture Jesus and his disciples in movement, feet walking on dusty, rocky roads, over miles and miles from village to village, lighting up one life after another. He called Matthew to follow him in his walking. He ate a meal with sinners and tax collectors. He raised a man's daughter from the dead. He brought people back to life and to health. He brought them back into relationship with divine presence. And as Jesus goes, as Jesus walks, we hear in today's gospel that he is approached by a woman who has been hemorrhaging for 12 years. Now, according to Leviticus in the Old Testament, this meant that she was ceremonially unclean. She couldn't enter a synagogue, her own house of worship. She wasn't allowed in. She was pushed away, moved away, shut off, because her impurity continued. And anyone who touched her or anything she had touched would be considered unclean. This woman came up behind Jesus thinking, if I can only touch his cloak, I will be healed, and he won't even have to know about it. But he did know about it, right? And instead of saying, what have you done? You have made me unclean. Jesus turns to the woman and says, take heart, daughter. Your faith has made you well. And just like that, she was healed, and her whole world changed in an instant. This is an incredible story that reflects Jesus' teaching in a nutshell. Here was a poor, unwell, outcast woman wending her way through the crowds, desperately reaching out her hand for help, and suddenly all the love and power of God in Christ concentrated for a brief moment in her. And in that instant, she went from nobody to somebody to everybody. In the first few days of our pilgrimage to the Holy Land, we were taken by our guides to Magdala, which is a prosperous first century village on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee, located between Capernaum and Tiberias. Magdala is not mentioned in the New Testament, but it is believed that Mary Magdalene, which most likely means Mary from Magdala, was born there. And you'll remember that Mary was a devoted follower of Jesus and also experienced healing from him. And it's also quite likely that Jesus visited Magdala and preached in it as he did in the synagogues of many villages and towns in Galilee. In 2018, a church was built on the site of the Sea of Galilee in Magdala, and it is called Duc in Ultim. And it's a Latin phrase taken from Luke's gospel, which means put out into deep water. And the church is home to six chapels. And there's a chapel in the lower level named Encounter. As our group moved inside and went to the lower level to have a chapel service of healing, which was officiated by ELCA bishops, Pedro Suarez in the center and Yehiel Curry on the end, and also pictured over on this side is Pastor Kader El Yatim, who assisted. And as I entered the chapel, my eyes fell on the mural painted behind the altar. Now, theologians and scholars, biblical scholars, archaeologists, have come to believe that the encounter with the woman suffering 12 years of hemorrhaging actually happened in this place, which at the time was one of the main roads in Magdala. And the mural was painted by Chilean artist Daniel Cariola and measures approximately 15 feet long by 5 feet high. And the idea was to capture that exact moment when the healing power came forth from Jesus into the woman. And the artist thought about the many possibilities of depicting the scene, but decided to focus on the humility of the woman. And that's how the title of the painting, The Encounter, came into being. Because it was an encounter between mercy and misery. What do you see in this painting? Feet. Feet. Jesus' feet. The apostles' feet. And a hand reaching out. Do you see Jesus' staff planted on the street stone? He has stopped. But notice everyone else's feet are moving. All of them seem to have this motion in them except for the foot of Christ, which is still in place. Now, while his other foot seems to be in motion, you'll see that something has made Jesus stop. The staff he holds is in place. And our gospel tells us that something came out of him. A power had come out of him. So Jesus stops and asks, "Who has touched me?" And this painting depicts that moment where her faith heals her. The artist wanted to make it clear that it was a great risk the woman was taking by reaching out to touch the garments of Jesus, and it took great courage for her to do so. It was crowded. It was hot that day, and she was sick. She was weak, but she makes her way as best as she can to Jesus. Out from Jesus emanates saving power, life. Now, these healing stories contain more miracles than meet the eye. Of course, the healing of the woman with the hemorrhage is a story we don't have difficulty remembering, but what about connecting it to the religious and social barriers that Jesus willingly crossed in order to help people in need? What about the miracle of faith that woman showed after suffering for 12 years? The fact that she was willing to seek healing says something about her invincible spirit. Regardless of past failures, going from doctor to doctor until she was penniless, she didn't give up. Her faith is no small miracle. Keeping faith in life's deepest, darkest moments is itself, I believe, a miracle. We could give up, but we don't. When we could throw in the towel, but we hold on to that last ounce of hope. That is a miracle happening. So many times, right? That's the best that we can hope for in the middle of our suffering. That's the best we can hope for. We can pray that our loved one will be healed, but many times it doesn't happen. It simply doesn't happen, at least not in the way that we had hoped. But sometimes the healing we do get is just as important. The healing of our broken hearts, the strength to pull ourselves together and get out of bed, to have the wherewithal to take one more step, even when it is a struggle. That too is a healing miracle. So what the woman in today's gospel teaches us is that faith is not just a dependence upon some outside power, but it is an inward knowing, a spiritual communion with Christ. 16 centuries ago, St. Augustine wrote that God loves each one of us as if we were the only person on earth, yet God loves all as God loves each. This woman who had been through so much, she never gave up hope. She never gave up hope. She sought Jesus out, and she acted on her belief, knowing that she was God's beloved. As are you, God's beloved.
Let us pray. God of healing miracles, God of blessing beyond our full ability to fathom, thank you for loving each of us as if we were the only one on earth, and for simultaneously loving all just as you love each of us. And God, thank you for a sense of healing and wholeness bigger than our minds can contain. Lord, we ask for your healing power to come to bear in this world, for healing between the nations, for a world in which there is healing within nations, between ethnic groups of people. We ask that you would help us to live in a world that is just, where people of all skin colors and all backgrounds, all religions and all cultures may be able to see one another as dignified because you love them. God, we ask for healing in places of great loss and grief, especially we hold before you all who lost loved ones in the crane crash in India and the train crash in India. And we ask that you would be with all who are dealing with grief, knowing that that is truly a journey that needs your healing presence. And we lift up now those prayers that are on our hearts, whether silently lifted up to you or whether spoken aloud with the support of our community. those challenging times, that we may know with conviction that you are with us and that your love is for us through all seasons. May that faith transform us to be vessels of your healing love. Through Christ our Savior. Now we return a portion of what God has first entrusted to us through our offerings. For God's Spirit to come and awaken God's church as we remember the ancient story, the story that binds us together of how in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus gathered with his disciples and he shared a meal in which he took some bread, he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it for all of them to eat, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all of them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new relationship formed in my blood, and it's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." I invite you to stand as you are able as we join in praying the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for all the people of God. All are welcome. You may be seated. freedom, thank you for feeding us with the very gift of your life. And now, through this meal, send us forth as your body in the world. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And I invite Valerie Thibault to come forward as we honor our high schoolers. And Valerie has the most beautiful ministry on behalf of St. Luke that you will get to see on the tables in the narthex. But Valerie.
Well, thank you, Beth. It's an easy ministry since I love doing it, so I think we all should have those kind of ministries. First of all, I want to congratulate our graduating seniors. Sometimes I think we take these little milestones and not celebrate them as greatly as we should, but it's not something that should be overlooked. We have great, great young people, I was gonna say kids, young people in our church, and 14 graduating from, I think, about 10 different schools this year. Good news is I had four new schools, so I had to go pick out four new school colors from my threads and things like that, so it kept me very busy. But I want to thank our seniors for sticking with us and being here, and to remind you, and I think this is why the Quilters and I have this ministry, that we're here for you, and we always will be. I've always thought of St. Luke as my family, and I, for some reason, looked up the term family in the dictionary, and it doesn't say anything about blood. It says an association of kindred spirits. So I think that St. Luke is definitely a family. And then the next thing I want to point out is, if you have time, when you leave, don't exit through the back door. Come up here and look at these beautiful, beautiful quilts that our quilters have assembled for our kids. One of the reasons I love that ministry, and it, dear to my heart, is that I hope when these young people are the college dorm and grab it to go down and watch a movie with their friends or whatever, they realize that when they put that wonderful quilt around their shoulders and on their lap, they're being hugged by their home congregation. So I hope you see it as a nice hug from all of us. And then when you come home on Christmas and over the summer and you're around, or if you stay in the Portland area, there's lots of hugs in the narthex. This I know because I like to give them out. So. And please honor them. I know a couple of them are here. I saw Katrina. Is Noah here too, I think, this morning? Anyway, please, please pick up your quilts and pick up your plaques and know how much we love you. Thank you, Beth.
Actually invite our high school seniors forward. We're not going to make you say anything, don't worry, but I see Katrina, I see Sam. We're going to have you come forward, and the whole congregation is going to give you a blessing. So please come forward and stand here at the altar rail entrance. Oh good, there's Noah. And Nick.
And Nick too.
Wonderful. So some of you we get to bless now, some will bless at the end of our 10:30 service, but we're so glad to be able to honor you for the work that you have done, the achievements you have made, and to thank God that you've been able to do them, and to pray your blessing on all that is to come. Congregation, I invite you to stand. These young people don't stand alone, they stand wrapped in our love. Yes. Forward towards our young people, our high school seniors, and this is a prayer for them and for all of us. Oh God, we thank you that you have brought us to this day. We thank you for the love that has sustained us every moment of our lives, and we know that you have called these your servants, all of us, to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils and adventures unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing exactly where all we will go, but only knowing that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us all the days of our lives.
our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now we invite you also to find, there should be an envelope with your name on it on top of your quilt.
Noah.
Okay, we've got Noah over here. I think Katrina, you're over here. And Sam, you're over here. Our blessings as we sing.
For our sending song, we'll sing a portion of it together before dismissal, in which you are free to enjoy this.